Well, good evening. My name is Lea Gilmore, and I am the First Service Music Director here and soon to be Minister of Racial Justice and Multicultural Engagement. Keith, we're going to talk about that, okay? Yes, I'm thrilled. I am so happy to introduce to you tonight one of the most talented young men I have ever met. He was just playing the piano for this small event. The organ, actually, for the small event. And I was stunned. I just sat there. Another Morganite. He went to Morgan State, like so many of us. HBCUs in the house. Yeah, okay. There you are. All right, Keith, I see you. And he's just a beautiful human. And so I'm going to introduce him in a little bit, and then we're going to keep going. Maurice says, music has always been a part of my life. Picking out melodies on the piano at 4, it was clear that he was gifted. Maurice began his professional music career at age 11, playing for local churches and choirs. Fast forward 7 years, and Maurice was accepting a full musical scholarship to attend Morgan State University with Dr. Carter. Oh yes, we know. For the next 2 years, Maurice studied intensely under the direction of Nathan Carter. Thereafter, Maurice changed majors to communications and English. It was then that he found his calling and began pursuing a career as an entrepreneur. After making the decision to become an entrepreneur, Maurice partnered with two close friends on separate occasions. The first was an art gallery that served as a space to rising visual artists and doubled as a self-defense class for women. Wow. And children, while providing a platform for a few poets. I did not know that. The second business was a multimedia company specializing in recording, mixing, production, photography, and videography. During this period, Stinkiface Music was born. That's his company, Stinkiface. Good. You can ask him about that and why, okay? Mr. Carroll founded Stinkiface Music as a record label designed to teach the music business to the artists they created their careers. The artists from Stinkiface were positioned and groomed to be dominant figures in the local area. This is not just due to sheer talent of the artists, but the directions that they received. Maurice then changed the infrastructure of the company, allowing any artist to benefit. Maurice has been doing music for many years. He's still quite a young man. And he's also the director of the gospel choir at Loyola University.
Right.
Tonight, we'll be talking about the gospel and spoken word. I can't wait for this. So I'm introducing to you Maurice Carroll. Woo!
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me. Thank you for being here, Maurice. Yeah. I've been looking forward to this ever since you asked me to come on. Mm-hmm. So, because I have a lot to say, and and you know me, I like to share information, and I love the wow factor with the information that I'm sharing, because I like that people don't always know what we in the industry kind of take for granted.
Right.
And so I know we're going to be talking about gospel music today and how it relates to spoken word and all of that. So I kind of wanted to start with defining where gospel music started.
Before you start, one minute. Sure. Everyone, you can ask questions via the chat and during the entire presentation, and I'll pose them for you. Also, we are going to put Maurice's tip box into the chat. So please be generous. Hold on, I'm getting an echo. I love Zoom so much. Maybe if I tell it I love it, it'll stop being so mean to me. So we'll be putting his online information, and you can support him how you see fit. So there you go, Maurice.
All right.
Thank you.
So I will say this before I even start, please ask questions, because that helps me to direct the information and helps me to be able to make sure that I'm getting to the core of the information that you're really interested in. All right, so with that said, I think it's important before we discuss how gospel music and spoken word are related and how they are so intertangled, I think it's important to kind of understand where gospel music came from and how it evolved and all of that good stuff. So one of the things that I found very interesting is finding out the who. There was a who. There was one person that kind of started the gospel music industry. His name is Thomas Dorsey, and before he was a gospel artist, he was a blues artist and quite prominent in the blues arena. And then, unfortunately, he had a tragic experience where a friend of his tragically died. And then Thomas Dorsey was inspired to, that's where his turning point came. He was inspired to write a song called Precious Lord, and which is still to this day one of the most prominent gospel songs that you'll hear in church, period, across the board. And so when he did that, it kind of turned his life around to a point where he was like, okay, I'm just going to dedicate my life to doing gospel music, and I'm going to, position myself, and I'm going to put my talents here and write and so forth and so on. So when I say this man wrote a lot of songs and had a lot of influence, he really, really did. So much so that some of the people that we know and admire and hear about in gospel so much, being staples, are people that he mentored. For instance, like Mahalia Jackson. Everybody knows that name, and what she's known for. She got crowned the queen of gospel herself. And just to know Thomas Dorsey was her mentor kind of says a lot to who he was in gospel music. I know I kind of want to play a little bit of Thomas Dorsey's singing Precious Lord. Let's go there. And let me know if I am in the right place. Yes, there it is.
You're sharing.
Great.
Let's go.
Precious Lord, I love your name. When I look back from whence I came, sometimes stumbling, sometimes falling, sometimes alone. Friends and loved ones I love so dear. Many, many are gone. Still I'm here. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. How are you?
So I really, really like hearing him sing that because it brings such it brings you down to the roots of gospel where you know where that came from. And to know that it was the first and like the original of its time. And then, like I said, when he mentored Mahalia Jackson and then penned songs for her as well, I said, man, this guy's on it. He's on it. So we're gonna do that one. Let's do that one.
Precious
And so here's why. So we heard the original way that he sang it, and then we heard what his influence was with Mahalia Jackson with singing it, right? There's a skill level inside of gospel music where you need to be able to interpret the lyrics, interpret the feeling, interpret the emotion, and you need to be able to, if you're a leader in gospel music, you need to also be able to teach that, which is a whole different skill in and of itself. You know, it's one thing to sing and play it and understand it, but there's a whole nother component when you have to actually teach it. And so understanding it is a key importance. And so with that understanding, I thought that learning and kind of knowing what the characteristics of gospel would be important to know. So, and why it's different from other music genres. So with gospel music, one of the things that's really, really prominent, and I dare say the most important, are the vocals. And when you're listening to gospel, the very first thing that you listen to is who's singing it, what are the backgrounds doing, and the arrangements, the melodies, all of those things are extremely important in gospel. Now, it's not to say that the instrumentation of it isn't, but it is to say that the vocals do come first, because we've rolled into an age where the musicianship of gospel became very prominent as well. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit later as well. But the vocals of gospel is what made it most prominent. And so the secondary thing was the emotion. And in both of the instances that I just played, you could hear the pain. You could hear the desperation in how they delivered the song, and that is the soul of gospel. And it is one of the core things when you are listening to gospel. You should always be able to hear whatever that emotion is supposed to be, whatever they're singing about. You should be, whether you speak the language or not, you're going to be able to understand the emotion. And that's one of the important things about gospel and how it was able to kind of go across seas and travel in different places. The emotion was so powerful that even if you didn't understand the language, you knew that the person was crying. You knew that the person was desperate. You knew that the person was joyful and ready for victory and ready for war. You always knew that based on how the music was delivered vocally, right? And so that is one of the targeted areas of gospel music. And it usually carries an inspirational message, and I'm saying that because I know where gospel is now. And so traditionally, gospel music carried the message of Christianity, everything biblical, even to the point where it had dual meanings. So what I mean by that is early on when you had Negro spirituals, what was considered Negro spirituals then had dual meanings. So you had songs like Go Down Moses that would be sang. And what would happen is they would sing Go Down Moses, but it was really a clue to know, oh, we're getting ready to go for our freedom now. Or in later periods, oh, Harriet is coming. Harriet Tubman's coming. That's Moses. We go down Moses. She's on our way. Let's get ready. And we're going to, you know, make our move. You had other songs like Steal Away that were Negro spirituals that talked about really the lyrics were really talking about the biblical portions of Steal Away and Steal Away to Jesus and really talking about your heart. But the dual meaning in Negro spirituals and the way that the slaves were singing it was that, okay, we're going to steal away, meaning, okay, we're about to go and meet up secretively and steal away to Jesus. It means, okay, we're going to sneak away. We're going to have this meeting about our plan to get to the north, to get free. And a lot of times, when the slave masters, because they weren't really concerned about the slave's spirituality, they weren't concerned about that at all. they were more concerned about how do we control them. And when that happened, It was strongly suggested to them that they use Christianity and songs and everything to kind of influence where they wanted them to be. So that is where the spirit of gospel music, the whole, that's where it was built. And then Thomas Dorsey came along and said, hey, you know what? I know blues. I have musical background. I can take that same feeling and make it a little bit more palatable to the musical genre. Okay, so now we have Thomas Dorsey that's writing songs like The Precious Lord and things like that, and mentoring people that were super, super influential to gospel music. So after Mahalia Jackson, I'm gonna move a little bit. After Mahalia Jackson, you had some other people that were really influential, like the Clara Ward singers. I don't know, Lily, you remember them? they were really, you know, influential.
Of course I remember them. My mother played them every Saturday.
Yeah. So in that instance, you know, you had people that were catching on to what Thomas Dorsey was doing. It's like, oh, well, we can do that too. We can build on it. Let's add some harmonies. Let's add some call and response. Well, why call and response? I don't hear that in really any other style of music. Call and response is when the lead vocalist says one thing and then the congregation, the people, or the background singers will respond with something else. Now, the reason why that came to be is because in gospel music, it was important to make sure that you were connecting with the listener. And so I'm going to make up words. This is not a song. I'm just going to make. So a lead singer could say, how are you doing? The crowd would say, fine. How are you doing? Fine, fine. Like, so there was a call and response there. And the reason why that is, again, is because just instead of presenting the music and saying, hey, listen to me sing and listen to this message, it became a thing where it became a conversation. And so that's where the things happened, where the dual messages in gospel music started to arise. So, okay, I get it, Maurice. Well, how does this relate to its influence on, you know, the different genres and everything like that? So to answer that, there are some artists that came out of the gospel music genre that blew up and had really, really influential careers outside of gospel. So you had people like, I know I'm about to name some names you all know, Whitney Houston, John Legend, Justin Timberlake, Katy Perry, Aretha Franklin, Brandy, Usher, Carrie Underwood. I could go on. It's a lot of them. It's a lot of them. But the significance about them, everybody that I named are people who had lasting careers, staples in the genres that they were in. And I think that's important because it lets you know what your foundation is, what you can build on. So because they had a really, really solid foundation in gospel, they were able to take that the style of music and take the emotional impact and translate it to other genres to catapult their careers in a certain way. And so how were they able to do that? How were they able to do that is the question, you know, because you have different genres, but you have the same result. You have the same influence. Everybody that I name has, they've been awarded certain things throughout their careers, et cetera, et cetera. So what makes them all similar outside of them being grounded in gospel? So my answer is it was because of the delivery of gospel. And I say the delivery of it is because in music, your listener is 100% waiting to hear what it is that you have to say and why you're saying it. And so in music, generally speaking, that is the bottom line. So in gospel, okay, you have the emotional aspects, you have the inflections, like how are they singing it? You have the tempo, how fast or slow is it? You have the message, what are they talking about? You know, and so they were able to take those influences and translate it into their style of music. So even if you had a John Legend writing a song and saying, oh, take it slow, you know, whatever, this time we'll take it slow. The lyrics in and of itself presents a question. Well, what are you talking about? What are we taking slow? And then throughout the song, he explains what it is. You know, Whitney Houston, and the most popular one that I can think of right now, was for a soundtrack. I can't remember what it was. I don't know what it was for. But she was singing, I Will Always Love You, right? And when she was singing that song, say again.
Bodyguard.
Yeah, thank you. I can see the picture in front of me.
a lot of random stuff.
So when she was singing that song, you can hear the gospel influence, because she started off in low mellow tones just to kind of draw you in, and then she pushed you all the way up, listening, and then when the chorus came up, that's when the heavy, I'm really feeling the song came out, when she took the deep breath and the part that everybody loves to sing, right? And when that happens, you just see her letting go and letting it all out in every video. So much so that anybody that ever imitates that song, that's exactly what they do. When they get to that chorus, they emote it as much as they can. So you have the inflections, you have the emotion, and you have the tempo, and you have the message. Strictly 100% influenced by gospel music, right? I know we have so many different examples that we kind of go through, but what I also want to make a distinction with is with gospel music, I think blues might have been the closest with being able to tell a story without telling a story. You know, having that influence of, okay, well, I can imagine what you're talking about, and we could be sitting side by side, and the visualization of what we're both imagining that the artist is talking about could be different because of how it was positioned. And that's great writing. In gospel music, that's how it's done. You know, we all know the different stories and the influences that can come and emerge out of gospel music, but then to take that, for it to be so strong and so solid, to be able to take that and then take it to another music genre like R&B or pop or hip hop or spoken word poetry or electronic dance music, and that same influence of storytelling and conviction still comes across because of where you came from. That speaks a lot to gospel music.
So Maurice, can you play some more examples? Oh, like you spoke so wonderfully about the buildup, you know? How okay. You never start a song strong.
Right, you're right. You never do. All right, let's see what I can pull. You know what? I know I mentioned Oh Happy Day, right?
No, but you just did right then.
Oh, I did. Okay. I'm sorry. Okay, so I skipped a part. All right, so Oh Happy Day is where gospel music as we know it, from the Negro spirituals to Thomas Dorsey, Oh Happy Day single-handedly changed what Thomas Dorsey was doing to what they call contemporary gospel. And here's a fun fact. When Thomas Dorsey was doing it, it wasn't even called gospel music.
Right.
It wasn't even called that at the time. It was called Holy Blues and Holy Gospel, I believe, or something along those lines, yeah. But it wasn't even called gospel music at the time. It hadn't been categorized at that point. So the Edwin Hawkins singers came out and with Oh Happy Day, and that's when everything shifted and a lot of things happened after that. Here's Oh Happy Day. Thank you.
happy day.
That's one of those songs, it can go and go and go.
That's all right. So I would just like to interject, because of course I want to, that, you know, we're starting, we had started a gospel choir at Govans. That's not an oxymoron. A gospel choir at Govans is happening. And right before COVID kind of exploded. And when we get back, that's the first song we're going to learn together. So all y'all better be ready to come to gospel choir rehearsal. With Maurice playing the piano, not Lea.
Oh my goodness. So
that song's all over the world.
Yeah, it is.
Can I interject?
Please do.
Please.
Keith Snipes, everybody.
I'm sitting here trying not to get teary-eyed, because that song, Oh Happy Day, is the song that my late mother used to conduct for us. My brother and my two sisters, she treated us like her little choir, right? And that was the song. That was her favorite song. And my mother, just as another tidbit, my mother, when she was a child, when she was a younger woman, used to sing in a group called the Fairmonts in North Carolina, which also included Shirley Caesar.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah. So they had a little singing group.
That's for real.
Yeah.
So you know, she's always wanted to sing. She had always wanted a singing career, and that's what got me out there singing. Mm-hmm. She was never able to do it, so I'm trying to carry that torch. So that song means, my God, it brings my mother back, if even only temporarily. Amen. You know.
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Keith. Thank you for sharing that, Keith.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had to. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
No, that is evidence of the power of the music.
Oh, my God.
That's the power. That's the
power. And that song, literally, all over the world, people know it. Mm-hmm. If you start Oh Happy Day in the middle of a Switzerland, and some little club, you just start singing, "Oh Happy Day!" All of a sudden, everybody standing up, go, "Oh Happy Day!" But they'll go, "Sister Act, Sister Act."
Right.
Wow! Beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that. That's really awesome, and such a beautiful testament of what gospel music does. Mm-hmm, and you know, and so many years later, so many different interpretations later, how it has the same influence as it did originally. You know, it just translates all the way through the different generations, and that is gospel music. That's the soul of gospel music. And so you know, I think that when the same applies when you take that kind of influence and you look at things like spoken word, you know, and one of the things, I'm gonna be transparent. I need to rewrite my bio. So, because there's some experiences that I have that aren't included in my bio. Like for example, I was a member of the Recording Academy for over 5 years. And if you don't know what the Recording Academy is, that's the organization that puts on the Grammys. And so I was a voting member of that organization for 5 years. And being a part of that organization opened my eyes to a lot of different things, one of which being what spoken word is. So in my background, I'm a poetry guy. I love hearing poetry. I used to write poetry. I love seeing poetry performed. And seeing poetry performed is what was categorized in that arena as spoken word, because you had to speak what you wrote. The difference is, and I know I'm gonna date myself, but I don't care. the difference is spoken word is Nikki Giovanni versus poetry being Maya Angelou. All right, so here's the difference. Maya Angelou can write, and she was known for, you can open up her book and you can interpret it and you can read it. Nikki Giovanni would say it, and she would project it and have her in inflections and things like that, and it took on a different embodiment. So that's one example. We have some other more recent examples, but for me, that was the defining point to kind of define which was which. And it's not to say that Maya Angelou wouldn't read or recite or speak her poetry. It's not to say that, but the intention is different, you know? So you can read or listen to something by Maya Angelou, and you can take in how you're interpreting it. But when you listen to how Nikki Giovanni spoke one of her pieces, she pulled you into a certain place. So I'm gonna give a quick example of what I mean by inflection. And this is a very elementary way of doing it, but I promise you, you'll understand exactly what I mean. So I can take a simple sentence as, I went to school today. I can take that one sentence, whether I'm singing it or speaking it or anything, how it's in a speech, whatever. I can say, I'm going to school today, that one sentence. I can change how you are perceiving what I'm saying by the inflection that I put on a certain word. So I can say, I'm going to school today. And so the inflection is on I'm, which means I want your attention to be on me rather than anybody else who may be going to school. I can say, I'm going to school today. And now the emphasis is on where I'm going. And so I can also say, I'm going to school today. And now the inflection is on the word today, which implies when I'm going. So in gospel music, and music in general, in spoken word, where you put your inflections are heavily influenced by how the people receive what you're saying. So, and we just listened to Oh Happy Day, right? What if the, because in that song, the word is on happy. It's Oh Happy Day, right? What if they said, Oh Happy Day? Then it changes it. It changes your perspective to daytime instead of versus nighttime. So things like that, when you listen to the specifics of how the words are inflected on, and the tempos and the emotion behind it, when we listened to it, you heard it was nice and calm. Soloist, call and response, like we talked about earlier. Oh happy day. And then the response, oh happy day, real nice and calm, all the way up until we got to the chorus where it exploded with the emotion, like they couldn't hold it anymore, you know. That same thing happens in spoken words. So I said that that I learned in the Grammys that spoken word was more than just spoken poetry, that it was also recognized as reading an audiobook. If you had an audiobook, that was considered spoken word. If you did a speech, that was considered spoken word. If you just decided to read poetry and recorded it, that was spoken word. Speeches. If you decided to give a public speech and somebody recorded it, it could be submitted as spoken word. And the reason behind that is because of all of the influences, because of the inflections, the rhythm, the emotion, the message, all of those things that we talked about that were the core of gospel music are also influenced in spoken word. So, okay, so let's look at how poetry, let's look at how speeches can and are associated with the influence of gospel music. You have things where, I'll use one of the most famous speeches ever with Martin Luther King and the I Have a Dream speech. When you look at something like that, it's more than just the words that he wrote and more than just the words that he said. It's also the rhythm of how he said it. It's also the inflections that he said. So the reason why I'm bringing this up is because when you mention the I Have a Dream speech, most people don't even know the first half of the speech. They know the part when he says, when he gets to the ramped up part, when I had a dream that all black, you know, when we all get to that point. And what's important, and my point is, with the rhythm, with the timing, with the emotional inflections and everything, the reason why that's the memorable part is because that is the part of the speech that had all of those same characteristics that are similar, if not equal to, gospel music in them. What happens? He raises his voice again and he watches his tempo. It's, I have a dream, pause. Da 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 da, pause. And all of his inflections are going upward. All of his tempo is say, pause. Say, pause. What also is wrapped up in there is the message. What is he saying? I get the rhythm pattern because I'm feeling that subconsciously. I get the inflections because that's bringing some emotion out of me. So I get that. Now, what is he saying? Oh, the whole point of it is the dream that he has about this life that he sees in the future. Okay, so the reason why, one of the reasons why that speech is important is because of the influences of the style and the emotion of what gospel music has been known to be, which is the emotion, the inflections, the tempo, the message. Just because you have tempo doesn't mean it's a song. You can have tempo in your speech. You can have a message in your speech. You can have inflections in your speech. You can have emotions in your speech. So with spoken word, there are messages, there's rhythm, and all of that. So fast forward in my career, there was a point where I was employed at a church, very popular church in Baltimore at the moment. I don't know, Leah, can I name drop? Okay. So, okay. So I was a musician at a church in Baltimore called the Empowerment Church. And the pastor of that church is Jamal Bryant, who in and of itself with, if you take away his controversy and all of that good stuff,
No one knows that but us, bro.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, he's a very influential speaker, period. No matter, you know, just period. And he embodied a lot of these different things with his tempo, his emotion, his inflections, and things like that. So at that church, they were a very progressive style church at the time. This is back in about 2002, 2005, somewhere in there. When I was employed there as a musician, they had a group that of spoken word artists that did poetry, and they were very good. They were definitely people who were taking time to write a very specific message, a very specific way, and I thought that it deserved a little bit of attention. And so in that, I said, okay, well, listen, guys, we're going to, I have an idea to kind of produce a track or two or three, and let's see, you know, what comes of it. And, you know, let's put an album together. And we did videos and everything like that. So what I want you to hear, probably won't play all of it because I definitely want to get to some questions. I'm gonna play a sample of what spoken word poetry can be, and when you listen to it, I want you to hear the content. It's a biblical, Christian-based, contemporary message. It is poetry in a contemporary way. It's not the traditional, every end of the line has the rhyme scheme and things like that. You will hear rhyme patterns in it. I want you to hear that. I want you to hear the music that is behind it that I produced, and to kind of feel, you know, why did I choose those instruments? Why did I pick that particular pattern? To kind of feel how all of it pulls together and creates the tempo, the emotion, the influence, and the message, how it combines all of it. Everybody still with me? All right, cool. All right. All right, let's see. And I don't see it as an option for me to share. This is weird. Okay, so let me try it this way. And Lea, I might need your help. I'm not sure if this is gonna work the way that I would like it to.
You played it earlier. It worked.
I did. Mm-hmm. Let's see. And let's go to downloads.
In the
interim, there it is. Okay.
Don't forget that Maurice's Cash App tip jar information is in the chat, and to ask questions. All right, go ahead, Tootie.
All right, here we go.
There's about a billion and one things that a brother like me won't do for cash, but he'll do for free. So my lips might rip what you don't get, but the Lord said speak so this shall be spit. This man on a mission ain't wasting his time writing sorry little raps just to get a few plaques. But I'm taking poetry to a whole nother place where the Lord be law and love be the case. And if it's going too fast, then I ain't walking with you. And if it's over your head, then partner, I ain't talking to you. I got a lot of real Christians who enjoy my sound. So if you don't mind, I'm about to get down. I'm lacing my shoes just to go 12 rounds. Got the Lord in my corner fighting pound for pound, making me one of the best to join his mob to do his work. You gotta love this job. What we do, me and thee, is take a whole bunch of lines and we tie them all together just to make a couple rhymes. Then we toss them flows like we throw it. Cause it's all about God with a praise this hard. I'm leaning on the Lord every day of my life. I don't cut with a knife, but I'm sharp and precise. Plus I do the God thing when I'm on my stroll, cause he's all over me and he's in control. I've never met a man with a word so tight that it takes my best to express it right. But I'm telling you now with a pen and a pad and a heart that's glad, I'ma make the devil mad, cause it makes no sense bumping me against the wall. Since I'ma do what I gotta, even if I gotta crawl, just to keep on writing and spitting and writing and spitting for the Lord, no lie, cause I love him, so I got to make my poems cry. You see, many people say my poems are just so tight that they flow so well, that the words are so nice, and they like the way my lyrics make people debate. Now I thank them for it, but let's get one thing straight. You see, like Nas, all I simply need is one mic to do what I do, spit for Jesus Christ. All right, if you feel me, snap your fingers two times and let this lyrically, poetically, spiritually dig into your mind. You see, I got a couple seconds to do my part, so before I start, spoken word is an art. When used to glorify my almighty Lord, you'll get all type of things you normally couldn't afford. I got stuff in my pockets that's ready to be shared, plus the butter in my head I'd love to spread and give you a little bit of my spiritual insight, cause I got what it takes to rock the mic right. You see, I stand before you now as a mighty child of God, dispensing his word so hard that you soon disregard any negative weapons that people display. Anything that wasn't worth it, man, effort to say. I mean, from me, you won't get everything you want, but you'll get what you need, and it's gonna be blunt to the point, straight facts coming strictly from God. And that's how I like to keep it real simple but hard, cause if I shout when I talk, then I dance when I walk, like a Billie Jean video radio lighted pathways in the dark. What I do is I write and I speak to the heart. I take phrases and phrases and I turn them into pages, cause Jesus said, player, pop your collar like
you better pop your collar.
He said, keep the praise coming and I'll keep them flows fast.
All right. I didn't realize it was so short, so I had to play the whole thing. But yeah, that was something that actually, this is the project. This came out in 2005. Full, I mean, I know they don't do CDs anymore, but you know, the CD, and then this particular project, let's see, it had a DVD. Okay, well, it had a DVD. And it, but yeah, the layout, like even having a mic pointed at a very specific scripture where it talked about delivering and being lyricists and things like that. It was pointed at that for a reason. But that was an example of what I was calling gospel spoken word would be. And basically taking you all through that whole line of saying, oh, this is where gospel started. This is how it relates to different styles of music. This is how it relates to spoken word poetry. This is how it relates to speeches, the flow, the, you know, all everything about it. So I hope that it brought a little bit of insight about the influence of everything. And the heavy influence that gospel has on the world as a whole, because we all know without music, where would we be as a world? Where, you know, music is, music is the true historian. You know, you can go to any period of time and listen to the music and really take on what was really happening during that time. And so hearing the progression of gospel music and the influences, especially with the artist and the songs and how they're built and things like that, all the way up to the speeches. I hope that it helped, and I hope that you got something out of it, you know.
So I have a question for you, Maurice.
I'm ready.
I'm going to start it all off before else just can't help themselves.
I'm ready.
All right. So, Maurice, when I listen to that, I also hear hip hop.
Yes.
In my head. So can you explain how this would be categorized as spoken word instead of hip hop? Or is it hip hop still? And rap? I mean,
so it wouldn't be considered hip hop because he's not rapping and there's no rap on it. So rapping means that you're staying within the confines of bars and making sure that you're ending certain phrases and rhyme schemes at the end of said bars. So it's not that, because as you heard that he was kind of riding the music, and it wasn't no da 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 ba ba da ba da 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 da. It wasn't none of that. He was just kind of flowing over top of it. Right. And so that's what hip hop is. You gotta find the beat, find the tempo, and stay within the confines of the tempo. The beat itself is not considered hip hop because there was no hard boom bap drums. You felt the timing, you felt the rhythm of it, but there was no doom dot doom doom. Like you couldn't hear the drum, you know, being prominent. So it wouldn't be considered that. It would be influenced by both African and classical at the same time. So in the beginning of it is where I decided, okay, I want to make sure that I increase the intensity. So at the beginning of it, I wanted to make sure that it grabbed your attention, but didn't take you away from the words that were being said. And as he escalated, the music escalated, or it switched and the music started escalating. And then you heard him match it. And then you heard when it plateaued because he was just in a zone where, and then you heard all of the string instruments, you know, coming in and things like that. You heard, you know, some kicks and snares here and there and things like that. So it wouldn't be quite hip hop. They wouldn't take it.
All right. So is it similar to, you know, the beat music? Do you, I mean, the beat poetry? Do you, maybe you're, we're both too young, but I know about it. Okay. The beat poetry of the like 60s, you know, where it's the same rhythm. And I think, is it just that it has a faith-centered dialogue with folks that is called spoken word gospel?
Okay.
It's so similar to.
Yeah. So what it is before our time, cough.
Not that much before mine.
What happened was when one of my favorites, Gil Scott-Heron.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
One of my favorites. He used rhythms to draw you back to a place where you could kind of feel Africa. You can kind of feel it in the percussive stuff, but he also incorporated the stylings of his keyboarding and bass lines and things like that to kind of make sure that it was Americanized enough where it was palatable for us to kind of take it. So he combined both. And in his rhyme schemes, you know, like the revolution would not be televised, even in things like that, he wasn't on beat. He was talking about things. And even in that, you could hear the different inflections that made the point. Like he specifically said, the revolution will not be televised. It will not be televised. He put the emphasis on not for a reason. He could have put it on televised, but that would have dated it. You know what I mean? So, you know, things like that in understanding where, how everything coincides is, yeah.
To think, or maybe Pastor Tom, this coming Sunday, we'll do The Revolution Will Not Be Televised. We may not have any more members after that.
That would be awesome. Let's do it. It's Pledge Sunday. What a great,
there
great
you thing go. To do on Pledge Sunday. But that means, Tom, that you have to do it. I'll send you the recording and you have to learn it, okay? So Maurice, Catherine has a question for you. She says, okay. Where would that poem, the one you just played, spoken word, be performed in? Is it in a church or what venues? Where can you find these performances?
So when this was done, when it was recorded, we had established an open mic night at one of the church's off sites. And what we did, we took the concept of what spoken word venues were, and we offered food. We offered, you know, beverages and things like that, and kept all of the traditional points of what a spoken word open mic night was. You had the host making jokes, making people feel comfortable, bringing an artist up. They do that poem, you get clap, 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 you sit down, bring the next artist up, so forth, rinse and repeat. What this group, the reason why I wanted to work with them, it was because what they did, they didn't care that it wasn't just in the church atmosphere. So they would go to a secular atmosphere where there was a bar and people was going outside to smoke and there was inappropriate language and things like that. And they would get on that same stage and do that same style of poetry and would stand up and say, hey, yeah, well, this is what we do. You need to come and see us. And I thought that at the time I was like, that's really bold. That's really brave. So that's where you can find that. Most of them, I don't know if they are still doing it. I'm pretty sure there's someplace somewhere where gospel spoken word artists are still practicing. I'm not in that circuit anymore, so I don't really know where they are, but I would encourage anybody who is a spoken word artist to pursue it. And if that's your belief and that's what you want to say, to go ahead and stand up and say it.
Maybe you can teach a spoken word class for us.
You know, I wouldn't mind doing that.
So there's another question here from Keith.
Okay.
He wants to know your thoughts around Sekou Sundiata.
Sekou
Sundiata.
I'm not sure if I know.
So Keith, get on, unmute and talk about it.
So Sekou Sundiata is, you brought up Gil Scott-Heron.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And Sekou Sundiata is, he was the poet laureate. At one point, he unfortunately died rather young, but he did, man, he did some incredible poetry to music.
Ah, right? Okay.
And he had one that, I'll just do the riff. He had one called Blink Your Eyes that said, I can wake up in the morning without a warning and my life could change. Blink your eyes. All depends on the skin. All depends on the skin you're living in. All depends on the skin. All depends on the skin you're living in. Right? Uh-huh. So but he was that kind. Man, the guy was deep. I thought maybe you knew him. I just wanted to.
Could you please put the name in the chat? And Maria, can you make sure I get that, please? Because
I think you would love
it. Yeah, I'm on that tip as well, and I got the opportunity to see him about maybe 2 or 3 years before he passed away.
Yeah.
At the University of Maryland, and I had read his work and knew of his work, but seeing him live with the poetry, with a live band, background vocalist, images behind him, the graphics, it moved me to tears. It moved me to tears. And that was part of his America series where he was talking about, oh my God, I walked out of there and I just felt like my life as an artist, it changed who I wanted to be as an artist. It really did. Yeah, so.
Gillespie, who did an evening with Deletta here a few months ago, I guess it's been that long.
Deletta's my people.
But yeah, Deletta's just an amazing singer, historian, everyone.
Absolutely.
I haven't seen that face in quite a while.
Yeah.
I've been underground.
I've been there with you, girl.
Yeah, I'm not surprised that you would like Sekou. I'm not surprised at all.
Rocked my world. You rocked my world.
Another question for Maurice.
Okay.
And this is from Pastor Tom. He wants to know how much of spoken word is improvised and how much is written out before it's performed. That's a good question.
90% of it is written. There's very little that's improvised. And that is mostly because with the message portion and the inflection portion of the characteristics that I was talking about. So you want to make sure, just like any pastor, you kind of know what you kind of want to say, and you have at least talk points. And then you might have a couple of scriptures you might want to pull. You might have a couple of quotes that you might want to use. Spoken word works the exact same way. You have what you want to say, you got a good flow. You might change the and or the, you might leave a little section for a little improvisation for the audience that you're in front of to make it personal, but most of it is pre-written.
Thank you so much, Maurice. Maurice, thank you so much for this evening.
Oh, thank
it's
you.
It's been really, really great.
Thank you.
I'm going to, let's all clap. Unmute for 1.3 seconds. Here we go.
Hey. Very good. Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you so much. I mean, it's such a fascinating world. And I think we take so much for granted growing up in it. But when we just look at the brilliance of what's happening, it's absolutely amazing. We're constantly growing as a people, mm-hmm. and the music grows with us. So we want to thank you very much for sharing that with us. And let's see, we will see you on the gospel choir tip.
Yes, we will. You know what? I'm sorry.
Yeah, listen to him play something. Yeah, play something real quick. Play something real quick. Play something, buddy.
I'll do something quick. All right, we'll stop.
That's what I'm talking about. And everybody can hear those blues chords, and you can hear the jazz and flex.
Exactly.
Those ninths and elevenths and stuff. Maurice, you're so super talented. So join us. You're going to play Oh Happy Day for us, and Govans is going to learn it, and we're going to sing it together. All right?
And Sounds good.
You're going to lead it. How about that? Chris is like, what? She talking to me? That's right, Chris DeRazzo. You're going to lead the song. All right. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
So next week, this is Music Mondays at Govans Presbyterian. And after me, you'll hear from our pastor. And we have every single week, every single Monday, except when we don't want to, but every single Monday, we have an event here, a music event. And we are, have been so amazingly blessed with the caliber of people who have come here to present, and just such a diversity of topics. We're not stuck in one place. We go all over the place with the music. All right. Thank you for coming. And Pastor Tom, you go and talk to something. Say something.
Thanks, Lea. Thank you, Maurice. Thank you for the sharing this amazing material with us tonight, and for all your talent and all your passion. Thank you, Lea, for leading these Music Mondays. And I think most of the people I've seen before and know before, so I don't need to give the Govans pitch except to say that everyone is welcome, and we are trying to do something really special and different and great at Govans, and so I hope you will be a part of it.